stare down, Roy, as George stared silently as at Briggs, and Briggs started laughing and talking to him in the middle of referee's instructions.
Yeah, and I guess that shows some confidence in Briggs.
Well, some of his supporters thought he might have been a little psyched out at the weigh-in where he refused to look at George. This was different. Shannon Briggs hoping for major redemption tonight. When he lost to Darrell Wilson a year and a half ago, his trainer Teddy Atlas left him. And when Briggs said that he was bothered by asthma in the bout, Atlas said he never said anything about it to me. He's had an awfully tough year. Shortly after that, his mother died, and then a very close friend was murdered. So he feels as though he's coming out of the shadows and perhaps into the spotlight tonight against Foreman. Briggs, who has been known to throw an average of 80 punches in the first round, is definitely not fighting at that overwrought pace in the first round here.
He's trying to move, use his jab and step away from George because he knows that George is looking to land those big punches on him. So he can't throw as many punches because he can't stand as still as he normally stands.
Briggs smiling as he moves around the ring.
Stop him.
His new trainer, Carlos Albuerne, said if he uses the ring and stays away from the ropes, he wins the fight. If he goes to the ropes, he loses. It's as simple as that. We've lost our clock temporarily. 1:30 left in the first round. Foreman trying to maneuver Briggs into the corners, and as slow as he appears to be, George is excellent at using the ring space to his advantage.
Yes, he is. He cuts the ring off. He makes you back into a corner. Once he gets you close enough and uses the ropes to trap you, then he throws his big punches.
Saw Foreman nodding at Briggs. They're having something in the way of an ongoing conversation in there. And there comes the Foreman jab, which was so evident in his conquest of Sabres this past spring. And you hear the crowd responding as George lands. A little bit less than a minute left in the round.
And Briggs is landing a pretty good jab himself here early in the fight.
Seconds left in round number one. Both fighters trying to establish their jabs in this first round. Shannon Briggs giving you a preview of the footwork that he hopes can win the fight, but there he puts his back against the ropes, and that provides the kind of opportunity that his trainer says he cannot afford to give to Big George.
Papa Cup, go, we hang out, you move for the other side and you hit it. Listen to me, all right? Mm-hmm. You win the first round. Bad. You need to use your job. Don't run it. Walk with him. Walk. He go with his side, you go with the other. Go.
Foreman, as has been his custom in the comeback career, standing in the corner between rounds, Angelo Dundee offering a few small nuggets of wisdom. And as round two begins, we're joined at ringside by the world heavyweight co-champion, if you will, Lennox Lewis. And Lennox, what did you think of the first round?
I felt the first round went pretty good. They're both getting used to each other. Shannon can't put his back against the ropes, so George will catch him. I think George is just waiting to set up a big right hand for Shannon. But everything's going well so far.
Which fighter do you think might be able to establish his jab first?
Well, it looks like Foreman's trying to get his jab going. I think Shannon's trying to mix up his punches and use his speed. George definitely has the experience and is using it.
Would you consider fighting George Foreman as one of your options if the Holyfield deal goes south?
Well, he's definitely an option to me. Whether he wants to fight me as well, one depends.
It'll depend on the money, Lennox.
Definitely.
What about if Briggs wins the bout?
If Briggs wins the fight, well, I know my friends down at Susie Q's wants me to do that, wants me to fight him.
Susie Q's is in New York?
No, it's in Toronto.
Uh-huh. Little inside stuff for Lennox Lewis as round two reaches the midway point. Foreman working behind the jab.
I tell you what, if Briggs doesn't knock Foreman out here pretty soon or knock him down and do something to gain some momentum back on Foreman, he's going to be in for a long night. Because the longer this fight goes, the more George is going to get into this fight.
Well, and when we saw the Sabaris bout early in the spring, you saw how George was able to wear down Sabaris and ruin him in the late rounds because of his incredible stamina, his great relaxation in the ring. Isn't that really his biggest secret, Lennox, the relaxation?
Definitely. That's where the experience comes in. You know, it just keeps on the pressure, and at the right moment, he knows when to turn it on.
Missing with the left there, but coming back to stick the jab, and Shannon Briggs, I totally agree with you, Roy Jones. He's fighting George Foreman's fight right now.
Yeah, he's breathing harder than George is.
Which is a good time for me to point out that I spoke with a psychologist before the fight who has worked with Briggs, and he told me that Briggs' biggest worry is that he doesn't have the stamina to go the distance because of his asthmatic condition.
Well, he's in bad trouble if that's the case.
Briggs manages to land a left over the top. Second round has been a pretty good one, though, both in terms of tactics and punches landed for George Foreman. Lennox, quick thumbnail prediction. Who's going to win the fight?
Well, the best man.
Ah, beautiful. Why don't you go back and run for prime minister, Lennox? Thanks very much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, Lennox Lewis looking forward to a possible fight with Evander Holyfield. Join us for the most recent installment of Real Sports with Brian Gumbel. Featured in this edition, a profile of Detroit Pistons superstar Grant Hill. A talk with NFL quarterbacks Boomer Esiason, Jim Kelly, and Mark Rippon about their son's life-threatening illnesses. And an investigative look at John Gillette, accused of swindling millions of dollars from top professional athletes. Real Sports, the only show of its kind, and it's only on HBO.
Being there with you. So steady jab, you're driving crazy.
The voice of the great Angelo Dundee.
Okay. Get on his case. He don't want no more. He really don't want no more.
Angie asking George to throw that telephone pole jab. And George starts to put a little bit more mustard behind the punches as round three gets underway. Shannon Briggs hasn't really released the right hand at all, Roy.
No, and hopefully he's saving it and waiting for those late rounds when he usually gets bored in a fight and has nothing to do. Hopefully he's saving his right hand for those times because he will need it tonight at that point.
This really shows you what a specific art boxing is. I mean, the athletic cap appears to be huge here, but George's technicianship gives him a vast edge in knowledge of what to do.
And let me tell you something else, Jim. The crowd plays a big part right here. Every time George lands a good punch, the crowd goes crazy. This has a psychological effect on the other guy, Briggs, because it makes him think, well, man, am I getting caught with big punches? Am I hurt or what? You know, it gives him, makes him think twice about himself. Stuff like that.
Well, if he doesn't know if he's getting hit with punches, he's got a real problem.
No, I didn't say he didn't know if he's getting hit. I said it makes him wonder again, or am I hurt? Am I looking foolish? What's going on here, you know? Makes him second guess himself.
It's a really good point, Roy. And it seems now
he's slacking and punching. You see that?
That Briggs has abandoned the style that he used in the first round.
Because he's tired. You get tired of running from a guy. It takes a lot out of you to run from a guy.
Riggs lands a left hook, but he's really in a defensive mode here. You saw him there with his back against the ropes, and we already told you what his trainer thinks of that. Now here he is backing into a corner by himself.
Hey, you know what I'm thinking here? You can run, but you can't hide. Same thing I was going to say for Griffin before the last fight.
It's not even a small ring. There's plenty of space in there.
It makes no difference. You can run, but you can't hide. Now, if he goes ahead and fights, then he can avoid George a little easier. But he can't avoid him by not fighting. He has to fight.
Right, stop punching. Stop punching, Shannon. Stop hitting him. No, stop hitting him in the back of his head.
Last 30 seconds of round three. So far, everything going George Foreman's way, or so it seems, against Shannon Briggs.
And I think
Good job.
Why is that, Roy?
Because once he gets inside, Shannon's got his hands up, his right hand up, looking for the left hook a lot. And George will sooner or later get inside, and Shannon's going to stay straight up, and George's going to sweep that left uppercut right under the right hand, and that'll be a dangerous punch.
Stop.
And I think that's George's best weapon because people don't see it coming.
Shannon looks awfully tired as round three comes to a close.
Nothing, Shannon. You listen to Uncle Al, it's nothing. Listen to your trainer and do what the hell he tells you.
Come
on.
Hold me. Why you don't use your right hand? Why you don't use your right hand? Tell me. No, you don't use it. Come on, baby. You want to lose the fight?
No.
Use a jab. Jab. Right hand. Come move.
You must punch Shannon. He's right. Come on. Take a breath. You're here for this fight.
Hold me.
Come on.
Come on, baby.
Okay, son, move over, slide on a guy. You know what to do. Slide. But everything is with your jab. No wide shots.
Okay.
No wide shots. Don't reach for him. He's ready to go.
Here's George patiently stalking Briggs. A left that was short. A right that wasn't.
And I tell you what, Larry, this Briggs corner is feeling this sense of urgency that we're talking about here.
Yeah, you heard veteran cutman Al Gavin play an extremely vocal role as he tried to shame Briggs into fighting, saying, come on, you're supposed to know what you're here for. Briggs threw an average of about 33 punches around in the first three rounds, and that won't get it done. He's got to throw at least 50 punches around to have
stop
a chance.
Stop hitting him in the back of his head. Stop hitting him in the back of his head. Okay. All right. Good job.
And you heard the trainer screaming for the right hand. Briggs not releasing the right hand up to this point in the bout. Shannon seemed to know that he needed to throw more punches as he came out for this round. But Foreman's been landing the jab at about a 70% clip.
One reason he's not throwing that right hand is because he can't see a target. George has that big jab up in front of his right hand, so he doesn't see anything to throw it at.
Easy pickings.
Good job.
George Foreman landing the jab with metronome regularity against Shannon Briggs.
Good job. Punch out. Stop punching.
My favorite expert observations when George sits next to me, Roy. This sport is easy if you have a jab.
Very easy if you have a jab. Oh, Shannon's starting to feel real bad now. And the crowd is not having a minute. Oh, good shot. There's that similar uppercut I'm talking about right there, Larry.
There's a hard right hand by Briggs as he suddenly comes out of his doldrums.
Yeah, but this is sort of like the last thing, the last straw. If that doesn't work, then what's he going to do?
Well, Briggs said that the Brownsville would come out of him sooner or later, meaning that he would fight like a Tyson, come out and roar despite his plans. But we haven't seen that part of him yet. Or a bow.
Well, for his sake, hopefully we'll see it tonight.
Briggs landing a left hook.
Stop punching. Good job.
He's landed more effective punches in this round than had been the case in the two preceding ones, but he's also taken some punishment.
In the back of his head, man. And the clips.
And referee Eddie Cotton continually warning Briggs for hitting Foreman in the back of the head. Now we're getting close to a penalty deduction on that subject.
Briggs is telegraphing his punches so much that George can see him coming from a mile away.
All right, stop one. Good job, fella. I like that.
Briggs should stick to his jab and stay away from George. That's the safest weapon he can use.
There, Briggs beat George to the punch with the jab, but it's happened all too rarely. Foreman doesn't look very pretty as he releases these combinations, but the punches just keep coming.
Why isn't he throwing the right hand, do you think, Roy?
Because he doesn't see a right hand target. Every time he looks, he sees George's big left hand there, so he doesn't see a straight shot to throw that.
So why not go to the body?
Because you don't fight a smart fight.
Nobody ever goes to the body against George. I don't get it.
Short shots, jab like you do. Hit this guy with a hell of a left hook. Don't let him bump you on your shoulder, okay?
Take it from me. Just get a little close weight and ram the hook. Hook right in his body. You got it weak.
Nice strong shot. In close, believe me, you can nail it with a left hook. Be close. Don't hook from the outside. Everything's okay. A jab. Jab.
Hey, I'm moving.
All right, everybody.
Go. Wait, look with me.
Angelo Dundee asking Foreman to get in close and nail his man with the left hook.
To answer your question, Jim, a lot of guys, when they see George tote them Jeeps around, they feel like body punches won't hurt this guy, so why throw it?
Well, they're probably right, too, but logic tells you plan A isn't working, you got to try plan B.
Go to corner. You got a glove, George.
Eddie Cotton with a piece of loose tape on Foreman's glove. Briggs in a neutral corner.
Yeah, clip this off and then put some tape on here.
Okay. Little cameo for Dundee here.
Okay.
And for once, Angelo didn't do this on purpose.
For once.
Hard right hand by Briggs. Every time Briggs seizes momentum for 5 or 10 seconds, George claims it back with the jab.
You know, this is so funny to me. You see a 48-year-old guy here faking at a guy, making him flinch, doing the things that the young fighter should be doing to him, you know?
Stop punching. Good job. Thank you.
Well, there's a simple question that you ask about every boxer at some stage of his career. Does he know how to fight? The book is still out on Shannon Briggs, but the verdict was in a long time ago on Foreman. If ever there was somebody who knew how to fight, this is the guy.
Born to fight.
Briggs getting a couple of open shots and taking them. Foreman lands that right across the top.
I think that might have hurt Briggs a little bit.
Well, you know, we've talked for years about George's ability to hurt people with glancing blows. You wondered if it was gone since he's gone 3 years without a knockout. But he may be in line for one tonight.
I tell you what, I seen George stop a guy with a shot to the back.
Did you? I'm not surprised. Letterman, how'd you score the first four rounds?
Jim, 3-1, 39-37, Big George Foreman. He just keeps walking him down, and wrapping him with that tremendous left jab. And the key to the fight is Shannon Briggs is just standing straight up like a totem pole. You can't miss him. He's got to bob and weave and move that head. You're asking him to do things, right, Harold, that he doesn't do. If he did those things, he wouldn't be Shannon Briggs.
If he did those things, George might not have chosen him from that opponent's list. That's another area where George excels. Matchmaking.
Oh, that was a good body shot, Jim.
Left hook to the body. I think that's something that Briggs ought to do every time it enters his mind.
Okay.
How are you ever going to know if George can handle body punches if you don't at least go there and try it?
You got a point there.
Stop punching. Put some tape on the glove. Put some tape on his gloves.
Hey, Dave.
Put some tape on his gloves.
Yeah. Whoa, whoa. What are we in?
Tape on the glove.
61%.
Where? Give me a channel. Give me a channel, Luis. Channel. You need a water.
Take a little water. Gotta use that right hand.
Beautiful.
Fine. Oh, come on.
Okay.
Back it up, George. Over here. Seconds out. I got him.
Pay attention to the other guy once in a while.
Let's go.
Round six of the scheduled 12. George Foreman against Shannon Briggs.
If Shannon can do that right there, jab, hook, and stay on the outside, step around George, don't let George have what he wants, that's his best chance to win this fight.
Yeah, that was out of the Morrison book on how to beat Foreman. Jab, hook, move out of the way.
Right there are the things he needs to do, but he has to keep doing it. He can't let George sit there and do nothing. He has to keep punching George like that, right there.
And he's got to try to give George angles instead of being in front of him as he has been throughout so much of the bout. But Briggs off to a decent tactical start in this round.
But now he stops right there, and that's what you don't want to do.
You know, these punches look so slow from George, you're thinking, how do they land? Obviously, it's deceptive.
Very deceptive.
Straight right hand by Briggs.
Very good right hand by Briggs.
That's a pretty good idea, too. You know, change up. Throw straight right hands and lead with them.
But he has to do it more often.
Pick him up, Sam.
So Briggs showing small pockets of awareness here and there. And Foreman continues to try to wear him down. Briggs is a big, strong man at 6'4", 227, but when George leans on him like that, it's got to take something out of him over the long haul.
Yeah, it does, but he's a younger fighter, and if he wants to win this fight, he has to stand up under that.
Stop punching.
Left hand to the chest, crowd responded. Briggs shook his head as if to say, hey, wait a minute, that wasn't all that big a deal. Why are you people cheering? Underlining the point you made earlier about how the crowd gets in his head.
Right, the crowd gets in anybody's head like this, not just him.
There's a quick left hook inside that landed flush for Shannon Briggs, and Foreman just keeps on coming.
That wasn't nothing.
All in all, to this point, Briggs has not been able to hit Foreman the way Savarese did, the way Axel Schultz did, the way Michael Moore did for 9 rounds. Maybe George is improving. Way through. Let's turn to another sporting subject entirely. Over the last 100 years, maybe no other sport has undergone as massive a transition as ladies figure skating. Join us in January as HBO Sports presents Reflections on Ice, a diary of ladies figure skating as we look back at the evolution, the sacrifices, the successes, the tragedies of ladies figure skating through revealing interviews and never before seen footage. It premieres January 27th right here on HBO Sports. Hello, Dorothy.
Nobody has to win, is it?
Oh, you guys don't get excited.
The other guy's loose.
This isn't ladies figure skating tonight.
No.
I gave Briggs the last round. I thought that was his best round since the first. I was about to start thinking he is submitting, giving in, but he found something in that last round. Let's see if he can exploit it.
If he continues to do that right here, every round he starts
out. Yeah, this looks good.
Every round he starts out just right. If he just can keep that up for 3 minutes and continue that throughout the fight, he'll have no problem.
Well, Briggs did manage to get off 48 punches in round six, his highest punch output of the fight so far. And perhaps not coincidentally, Harold Letterman gave him the round also. So let's see if Briggs can build on what he did in round six and mount a rally against the so far more effective George Foreman.
I think George is going into the toe-to-cheek mode now.
Foreman going mostly with the jab. Briggs throwing the greater variety of punches. Big power punch edge for Briggs. In round six, he landed 17 of them to only four for George.
Okay, all right. Let's go.
He's doing a smart thing here, Briggs, by throwing these snapping punches while George's punches are winging, because you have to land a quicker punch. If you're quicker than a guy, use your hand speed on him.
And watch them hands, let them go, let them go. Hands free.
Briggs keeping Foreman occupied inside.
Watch them hands.
Going to the body so that Foreman doesn't have a chance to throw that uppercut, which might have done so much damage.
All right, stop punch, stop punch. Good job.
Foreman hasn't landed a good punch on Briggs for some time now, though.
Which is mostly due to the fact that Briggs is just handling himself better. I don't think George is tiring or changing.
No, I think Briggs is doing the right thing. He's not fighting George's pace. He's fighting his own pace. He's throwing quick, sharp punches, and he's keeping George on the move. That's the way to beat George for a young guy here.
Maybe it took Briggs five rounds to settle down and get his head straight and remember what it was that he planned to do.
It's been a while since he's been in against an opponent like this, though, you know?
Watch him heads, hands free, bottom heads.
He's never been in against an opponent like this.
Well, somebody with the name on HBO, you know, it's different when you step up with this big TV scene. It's a whole lot of difference, you know? You have a reputation to uphold when you fight here.
In all honesty, when we had him on against Darryl Wilson last year on HBO, that was a showcase for Briggs. We ran a profile of him, which was a star profile. We were as shocked as anybody when he folded up like an accordion after Wilson hit him in the mouth.
Well, there's a lot of pressure there sometimes, and people don't realize the pressure that a person is under when you profile him and you do all these type things, and it's the first time.
Okay, stop punching, stop punching, stop punching. Good job, fellas.
Foreman going back to hitting Briggs flush in the mouth with the jab. Shannon Briggs with a combination to the body, and the right uppercut to the chest was a real good idea.
And now he's out punching George, he's out working George, and I think he's fighting a lot smarter fight now.
Come here, son.
You can do it all night in close. Deep breath. Throw a feint once in a while, it's pretty. You paint them out of position, nice. Get the jab.
Good round. Good round.
That's
good
great.
Round. Come in. Go down. Go. Put it down. Listen, baby. You win the fight. The fight is too close. He's the champion. He's the eighth round. Four more rounds, you are the champion. What happened to you? What do you want? Or you want to hit it to you? Come on, baby.
Right, son. It's all the way.
Go. Go with me.
Don't let him hit you. Keep him backing up with the jab. Train him, see if he'll go for a sucker shot. Go, man.
George Foreman is a compelling figure in boxing. This is not a compelling fight.
Show ain't. But at least it's changing. In round six or seven, Briggs found a formula for limiting Foreman's opportunities, as is evidenced by the fact that CompuBox numbers in round seven showed Foreman attempting only 21 punches. Here's a hard right hand across the top by Foreman. Briggs shakes his head, but that punch landed. Harold Letterman, how you got it through seven?
Jim, I got it. 5 rounds to 2, 68-65, George Foreman. I think he hurt him in the seventh round with a couple of punches he landed. Thought he won that also. He certainly lost the sixth round, but I'm talking about Foreman. But he just keeps walking him down and wrapping him with the harder shots. I think he's winning the fight.
He's winning the eighth round. That much I can tell you.
I have it 4 rounds, 2 and 1 even.
Stop it.
I always manage to find an even round.
I was just about to say that, Larry. You know, if they go one round, I think you got that one round even from the get-go, you know?
The even cameo on Larry's card.
I'm glad I got it out of the way.
Foreman over the top with the right hand. Foreman with a hard left hook.
Stop point, George, having his biggest round
since early in the bout.
Yeah, and because Briggs is not being offensive now. Briggs is all defensive, and he's letting George be offensive. The best defense is offense.
His feet have stopped moving, his hands have stopped moving, and he's letting George hit him. Now Briggs lands a left hook across the top. Great point. The best defense, particularly against a fighter like Foreman, is a good offense.
The best defense, period, in my case, I think, is a good offense.
George hard right it. Hand.
At least that's what my dad taught me.
And he taught you well.
That was the hardest punch of the fight for George. He must sense that Briggs is weakening or that he just doesn't have any more movement.
Why is Briggs standing straight up here taking these punches is what I would like to know.
Maybe Briggs expended so much energy in rounds 5 and 6.
Yeah, but he can slip the punches. He's in there. Oh, good shot by Briggs. Now, that was smart.
Left hook to the body down low. Very
smart shot.
Hard right hand across the top for Foreman. Round 8, the biggest crowd pleaser of the bout.
You can't let Foreman rally like this because on this rally, he's 48 years old. He may get a 10-8 round here for this big rally. And then you better knock him out to win the fight now.
That left hook to the body if Briggs will keep throwing it. That's a very good idea.
Listen, you don't want to war, you lose the fight, all right?
No.
Go up. Hey, matter with you. What happened? You won too many for Nazi. Maya, cool. Pinga esto. What's that with you, baby? Go with me.
Double punch.
Ninth round. Turn it on.
Take a look at that flurry of punches from George. A combination of left with a right behind it. A half hook behind that. Oh, George is he's like an old lion who can still mangle you if he catches you.
Nice and steady. And Foreman, who threw 21 punches in round 7, threw 67 punches in round 8, and landed 64% of them. So it was a huge round for Foreman, fueled by the jab. He was 25 for 36 in that category.
Shannon needs to tighten up here and win the rest of these rounds if he wants to even be in contention for this fight.
Four rounds to go.
Did they say Shannon Briggs the one that had asthma, or was it the corner man? The corner man seemed like he was struggling a little bit just now. Or maybe he was just overexcited.
Maybe the asthma is contagious. Although Teddy Atlas, of course, never caught it.
I don't think that Teddy Atlas questioned that he had asthma. I think his concern was he never raised it before. Why would you raise it after you lose your first fight? Sounds too much like an alibi.
Stop punch. Step back. Good job.
Well, Atlas also claims that when he spent 4 hours with Briggs at a hospital after that fight, waiting for Shannon to get his eye stitched up, that Briggs never said a word to him about asthma during that period of time. That's Atlas's claim, and Briggs says, I've never been so hurt in my life by somebody who would defame me after having been so close to me for so long. He also says that Atlas was trying to make him a puncher, and that he believes deep at heart he's always been a boxer.
Well, these are things that you have to talk out amongst one another while you're working together. You don't wait till it's all over to start working things out. That's how things get so confused. That's how problems come about. When you don't have communication, you mess up an organization.
Well, that's yet another Briggs observation, that working with Teddy Atlas means you listen while Teddy talks.
Well, then Teddy needs somebody that can't talk. But I know a few guys like that, man.
Foreman crunching Briggs inside with a left hook. They trade body shots in close. And Briggs punctuates the exchange with a right cross. So Foreman chases him across the ring and lands his own right cross.
And I'm going to tell you something. Briggs can't keep getting hit with his right hand or it'll chop you down. George is chopping on him just like he chops on those trees. If he keeps on knocking little bitches out, he's going to eventually chop you down. Good body shot by George. George throw the hook by the hook head. Oh, Shelton is in George's territory right now, I have to say.
Well, give him the gold star for bravery then.
Yeah, because he's fighting.
Dominant tactic in the bout so far, George Foreman's legendary jab. It's been the bulwark on which his entire career has been built. Larry Merchant, take us through the replays of Foreman's jabs.
Well, George, this was almost a non-existent punch for George in his first career. It's the punch that has sustained his second career. This is a medley of jabs. And he's not just touching Briggs.
Yeah, give me. Charlie, tie it on.
Come on, try the wrong way.
Come on.
Hold his head.
Go. Don't let it slip.
Come on.
Come on.
That's it.
That's it.
George himself has a little bit of swelling under his eyes. He has been hit with some jabs himself.
Jabs through round 9, Foreman landing 120 of 177, Briggs 44 of 104.
Briggs once again starting out the correct way.
10 rounds is as far as Shannon Briggs has ever gone in his career. He got a 10th round TKO over Valdez in his last bout. Briggs lands a right hand across the top. He had a big rally in round 9 of the Valdez fight. Let's see if he's got something saved for rounds 10, 11, and 12 here.
Now that goes into the books or into our computers as a jab. That didn't look like any jab I've seen before.
Looked more like a straight left hand by a southpaw to me.
Larry, among all the heavyweights you've ever covered, whose jab did you like the best?
Larry Holmes had a great jab. Ali.
Sonny Liston.
Liston had a hammer, a really big jab. I don't think anybody depended on the jab as much as Larry Holmes did.
Larry's here tonight in the crowd. Veritable who's who of boxing tonight. You've heard from Lennox Lewis. Brunell Whitaker sitting in the row right behind us. Young heavyweight Michael Grant. Here to observe his compatriot, Briggs. David Tua fought on the undercard.
Oh, that body shot might have hurt Briggs.
Pick him up, pick him up. Come on,
Stopped
Shannon.
Briggs in his tracks for the moment, but Shannon resumed throwing punches. If you joined us late,
on,
David
guys,
Tua,
let's get him up.
In his first
Watch
bout since his loss to Aiki Deabuchi, beat Jeff Lally in a second round knockout. Totally one-sided affair that Tua dominated with body punching. He knocked Lally down 5 times.
Well, the good thing about the young fighters is, once you think you got one that's just about to make it, just about to bust onto the scene, you find something tough come out from around the corner and upsets him, you know? That's why I like to see the young guys fight so much. Body shot by Shannon.
Hard right hand at the body. Sets up a combination up top. Foreman feels the need to come back with a certain fury, but Shannon Briggs with some very effective stuff in round 10.
Highly effective.
Come on.
One more round.
Good round.
Good man. Go. Go with me. Go. Put a foot. Put a foot.
Go.
Take a while.
Baby, 11 rounds. Watch. 11 rounds. You doing two more sensei with this, you win. You are the champion. You understand? Go, baby.
We need to work these last two rounds, baby. We need to work.
Baby, you should jab. You should jab.
Try to swing with it. Like when you get in close, try that instead of walking. It might crawl when you're crossing.
I don't understand.
Okay, come on. At right hand.
Body shot. That one stopped Briggs, hurt him. Briggs came right back, took that idea, and then popped George on top of his head.
If Shannon is a gambler, he just rolled himself a hard 10. Now he has two more to go, and he'll be all right.
Good job.
Shannon Briggs dominating round 10, landing 28 out of 44 punches, 64%. 20 of those lands, power shots. Let's see if he can step up the pace yet again in round 11.
All right.
Whatever happens in this fight, what you look for in a young fighter is heart, courage, championship stuff. I don't see it in Briggs even if he wins this fight.
Well, I see a little bit of it because he's taking some good punches tonight. He's showing some good angles. He's throwing some pretty good punches.
Harold had to have it through 10.
Jim, 97, 93. 7-3, George Foreman. I tell you, Jim, I always score somehow or another for the effective aggressor. He's just carrying a fight to Shannon Briggs. I mean, Shannon's landing some awful good shots in this fight, but George keeps walking him down. He is the effective aggressor. He is landing the harder shots. I think he's winning the fight overall. Shannon could make it close in the last two rounds, but I think George has got enough rounds in the bank to win the fight.
I have it 6-3 and one even.
Watch him ahead! Watch him ahead!
What's your instinct, Roy? Either man got a chance to score a knockout in these last 4 minutes and 40 seconds?
Of course, both men still have a chance to score a knockout. Briggs is a big puncher. George, as you know, is one of the biggest punchers of all time. So either guy could score a knockout, but at this pace, I don't think we'll see one.
Five of Foreman's last seven fights have gone the distance.
Okay, right, stop punching.
Knockout over Pierre Kutzer in the eighth. Knockout over Michael Moore in the tenth.
Stop punching the back of his head, man.
Those seven fights have averaged nearly 11 rounds apiece.
Let's go.
If this goes the distance, it'll be yet another 12-round effort by Foreman as he approaches 49 years old.
Come on, I want to clean.
Another thing that some of these younger guys don't understand is that if you're fighting a guy over 40 years old, the judges expect you to go out there and dominate this guy. They're not going to give you a close fight against this guy because you're the one who's supposed to go out there to show yourself. You're supposed to be the showcase.
Briggs badly off balance as he landed the right-hand shot.
Watch him head.
Incidentally, 11 years ago tonight, Mike Tyson became the youngest heavyweight champion in history, knocking out Trevor Burbick in the second round. Of course, if Foreman, by some stretch of the imagination, can get another shot at the heavyweight title, he will again be trying to become the oldest man ever to win it, as he was the night he knocked out Moore. Hard shots by Briggs.
He's trying to knock him out. He's trying his best to knock him out.
I think he's shown more courage and stomach in the last three rounds than in his whole career up to that point.
My point's too. I think he has.
Last round.
Good man.
Very nice. Got only last round. That's all there is, son. Very nice. Good. In close.
You have a thing to me? All right. Now, it's the 12th round. Watch it. The last round. Watch it. The last round. The last round. It's a jab. Jab right here and move.
Last round.
Go.
Yeah. You got to let your hands free. You got to use
a
jab.
Jab come. Take it. Jab. Get closer.
Last one.
Everything.
You're definitely there.
Come on.
No more. Very nice, son. Steady, steady. Don't get sloppy, okay? Let's see a lot of jabs.
Round 12 of George Foreman's 81st professional bout. Shannon Briggs, probably behind on the scorecards, probably needs a knockout.
I think so.
Foreman trying for the knockout with that hard right hand over the top, and it was short. Landing to the body, comes back with a left hook. Jab, jab. Foreman, the busier fighter in the first 40 seconds of the last round.
All right, let's watch some heads in there.
Good 1-2 combination by George. A left hook followed by a right hook.
Right now it appears that Briggs is just trying to last the distance that he has submitted to George's enormous will.
Fourth root going performance in a row for Foreman, if we hear the bell for round 12. Hasn't had a knockout since the Moore fight. Maybe he doesn't need knockouts to keep winning at this stage of his career.
All right, stop punch, stop punch, stop punch. Come on out. Come on out.
As long as he can choose his opponents this carefully. Blood around the edges of Shannon Briggs' nose. Visible evidence of Foreman's 12th round attack. All Foreman now as Briggs backs up. Crowd rises to its feet. Another giant ovation for the boxing giant.
I tell you, Shannon Briggs is really showing some heart here tonight, though. He's fighting. He's not running. He's not being afraid. He's trying. He's letting it all hang out. But George may be the most incredible thing I've ever seen.
Briggs landing a left hook inside. Foreman coming back with a left right of his own. 30 seconds to go.
Okay, let's go. Stop punching. Good job.
Three judges at ringside, probably holding the fate of Foreman's career in their hands. Hard to imagine that he could rebound in a business sense from a loss at this point, but to our eyes, it appears he's not in danger of that.
His courage, Briggs, came too late.
You saw what were no doubt words of encouragement and support from George Foreman to the man whom Foreman no doubt believes he has just defeated. Harold Lederman, how'd you finish up with the scorecard?
Well, Jim, I'm not one for giving a fight to a guy that runs away. And certainly Shannon Briggs ran for 12 rounds from George Foreman. Judge took it to him. I think he deserves this fight. 116, 112, 8 rounds to 4, George Foreman. I just loved him on effective aggressiveness. I thought he landed the harder shots. Shannon Briggs did see his blood in the 12th round and certainly didn't fold up. He punched back. But even still, George took it to him. George landed the harder shots. George did more damage. Foreman, by a decision, 8-4.
Amazing grace. Under pressure in the late rounds from Foreman. Came out and seized the 12th round to punctuate his statement to the judges.
And you wonder, how can a 48-year-old man continue to come out and outwork these young guys? It's just so unbelievable.
Well, what amazes you more? What he did here tonight, or that video of him pulling the Jeep up a hill strapped to his back?
Of course, you know that Jeep is the most amazing thing I ever seen.
And final CompuBox punch stat numbers for this bout. Foreman landing 284 out of 488. Briggs throws 6 more punches but lands 61 fewer. Foreman with that extraordinary 58% connect percentage, made even more extraordinary by the fact that to the layman's eyes, every punch appears to be thrown in slow motion. Jabs. Foreman landing 157 out of 230. 68%. It's almost as if he walks up and says, I'm going to hit you with a jab, and you're not going to be able to stop it. Briggs, 57 out of 135, respectable, but probably not enough. Let's go to Michael Buffer.
From the Trump Taj Mahal in Atlantic City, we go to the Budweiser scorecards. Steve Weisfeld scores the bout. 114 to 114, he has it even. Lawrence Layton scores the bout 117 to 113. And Calvin Claxton has it 116 to 112 for the winner by majority decision and new linear heavyweight champion of the world, Shannon Briggs.
Huh?
Yeah, that's how boxing goes. That's why it's very unsafe to just go in there and assume that you're going to come out a victor.
Not the first time that the three judges at ringside have seen a different bout than the one that we watched. Fifth loss of George Foreman's career. So Shannon Briggs joins the list of names that begins with Muhammad Ali and includes Jimmy Young, Evander Holyfield, and Tommy Morrison. And Briggs' career is revived in a heartbeat, as long as it took for Michael Buffer to read the scores. Audience does not agree with the decision. Claxton, 116 to 112 for Briggs. That's a simple 8-4 for Briggs, including 6 of the last 8 rounds to Briggs in Claxton's scorecard. Lawrence Layton, 117 to 113 for Briggs, including 7 of the last 8 rounds to Briggs. And Steve Weisfeld is the man who saw it even at 114 apiece. He gave each of the last 2 rounds to Foreman, and indeed, Weisfeld gave 4 of the last 5 rounds.